Hello everyone, this is Rick and today we are going to discuss about the Sangam age from an archaeological perspective. In our last video, we have discussed about the political history of the kingdoms during the Sangam age, namely the Cheras, Cholas and the Pandyas. Today we are going to dive deep into archaeology and see what kind of cities existed in the far south of the Indian subcontinent. So without doing any delay, let's get into details. Graeco-Roman sources and urban centers. What were the sources of information regarding these urban centers? The Graeco-Roman text highlight many South Indian towns and cities using emporium for coastal towns associated with foreign trade. So there existed a trade relation between the Roman Empire and that of the southern kingdoms. And so the Graeco-Roman text used the term emporium to denote the coastal towns which were associated with foreign trade. The Tamil term Pattinam means port, used in Kaverippumpattinam, which is Puhar in Sangam literature. So Pattinam is a Tamil term which means port, where ships used to dock for trading purpose. And one such famous port is Kaverippumpattinam, which is Puhar in Sangam literature. The Sangam poems describe the urban centers, but archaeological evidence often doesn't match these descriptions. So all the urban centers have more or less been described in the Sangam poems, but when we excavate them in an archaeological methodological basis, that time the descriptions most often does not match. Cities like Madurai and Kanchipuram have been continuously inhabited, hindering horizontal excavations. So there are ancient cities like Madurai and Kanchipuram which has been under continuous occupation for thousands of years. Hence, it is very hard to do horizontal excavations in these sites. Historian Champakalakshmi provided a comprehensive account of the urban centers of early historical South India, noting excavation challenges and importance of literary sources in reconstructing the historical urbanism. So the works of historian Champakalakshmi is very much important to understand the urbanism in South India. Vanji, Kuruvur or Karur. So these three names correspond to the same city which has been popularly called as Vanji. Now where was Vanji? Vanji or Kuruvar or Karur, the Chera dynasty's capital, is identified with Karur in the banks of Amravati river. So present day the city of Karur can be identified with Vanji, and this was the Chera dynasty capital. We have discussed a lot about Chera dynasty in our last video. So please go through that in order to understand it properly. 11 Sangam poets hailed from Karur, highlighting its cultural importance and literary significance. So Sangam literature had a lot of brilliant poems writing them. Hence, 11 of them hailed from Karur, which is a significant number depicting the cultural significance of Vanji in the Sangam period. Literary, archaeological, numismatic and epigraphic evidence confirms Karur's status as a political center and a hub for crafts and trade. So all kinds of archaeological evidences have been found from this site, including literary evidences also. And among the archaeological evidences, numismatic and epigraphic evidences are very common. So all these together confirms the status of Karur as an important political center and also as a trading center important for hub of crafts. BRW, which means black and red ware, with graffiti marks, pieces of Roman amphorae, and locally made rouleted ware has been found. So these indicates that there was a proper ceramic activity conducted on the site of Karur. And BRW with graffiti marks is very significant, denoting ancient age of India. And also along with that, we find a Roman amphorae, which denotes the fact that there was significant amount of foreign trade done during this time. Copper coin belonging to Claudius have been found at Karur. Larger quantities of coins are found in Vellalur and Amravati riverbed, indicating extensive trade. So copper coin belonging to Roman Emperor Claudius being found in South India indicates the extent of trade of these kingdoms. Karur's significance in trade and crafts. How was this city very significant in trade and crafts? Karur was a significant center for crafts and trade. Archaeological findings include hundreds of copper coins, and these copper coins have many foreign elements in them. So it was a very significant center for crafts and trade. Coins with bow and arrow symbols and Tamil legends indicate local minting activities. So coins were not only gained from foreign trade, but also many of the coins were minted locally, and that can be understood from the Tamil symbols like bow and arrow. Finger rings with various motifs, including Greco-Roman styles, signify diverse cultural influences in Karur. So there were finger rings with various motifs, and those motifs have had Greco-Roman influences in them, and thus we get diverse cultural activities in the city of Karur. Early Tamil Brahmi inscriptions at Pugalur and Archchalur record donations by Chera rulers and merchants. So there are Tamil Brahmi inscriptions also on the sites of Pugalur and Archchalur, which record that several Chera rulers donated to these ancient trading institutions. Inscriptions highlight Karur's role as a major trade center, associating it with specific merchants and craftspeople, emphasizing its importance in regional and international trade networks. So this was a city which was very significant for its regional and international trade routes. Muchiri or Muziris. Now this was another important city, and it was the foremost, it was a port and was a major port in Chera kingdom, prominently mentioned in the classical accounts. So this was another major port of the Chera kingdom, and it has been mentioned in many of the classical accounts. Periplus of Eritrean Sea, which has been authored approximately during the 1st century AD by some unknown sailor, it describes cargo-laden ships from Arabia and Egypt landing at Muchiri, listing numerous imports and exports. So, ships, fully loaded ships with cargoes from Arabia and Egypt used to land in this port at Muchiri, and thus there were numerous importing items and exporting items also. There were pirate dangers during this time, as has been noted by Pliny the Elder, requiring ships to anchor offshore, referenced in Vienna Papyrus. So Vienna Papyrus is another important source where Pliny the Elder has mentioned that ships needed to anchor offshore for the fear of pirates. A second century document records goods transportation between Alexandria and Muchiri, illustrating the extensive trade connections. So there was trading relationship between Alexandria and Muchiri, and thus we get evidences of extensive trade connections during the Sangam age. The trade accounts detail trade involving spices, textiles and precious stones, underscoring Muchiri's pivotal role in Indo-Roman trade and its economic significance for the Chera kingdom. So this was a very significant town for its pivotal role in Indo-Roman trade and also for being a significant economic market of the Chera kingdom. Now Madurai. Madurai was the capital city of the Pandya kingdom, and it is a very celebrated place in Tamil tradition as a site of Third Sangam. So this is very famous city culturally even today, and this is the site of Third Sangam. City layout described in Madurai Kanchi as a large city enclosed by walls with palaces, temples, large houses and two markets. So what was there mainly in the city? First of all, it was a city which was fortified or enclosed by walls. Inside the city there were palaces, temples of different gods and goddesses. There were large houses and two important market places. This city was known for gold ornaments, ivory work, kank cutting and bangle making, indicating its importance as a craft and trading center. So this city was known for its gold ornaments and different kinds of other trading activities like ivory work, bangle making and other specialized handicrafts industries. Tamil Brahmi inscriptions found in the surrounding areas mention merchant endowments recorded at Alagar Malai. So Alagar Malai is a thing where merchant endowments have been recorded, and it has been recorded in the form of Tamil Brahmi inscriptions. Sangam literature describes Madurai's prosperity and role as a major center of trade and crafts, with references to traders selling pearls, precious stones, further evidenced by the Arthashastra. So even in Arthashastra, we get mention of Madurai as an important trading center. Korkai. Korkai is another important port city, a significant Pandya port, renowned for its pearl fisheries mentioned in Sangam poems and Greek accounts. So this city was very much famous for its pearl fishing activities, and it has been mentioned in numerous Sangam poems and also in Greek accounts of the contemporary period. Arthashastra refers to Korkai's pearl fisheries, highlighting its importance in ancient trade networks. And Arthashastra was authored during the Mauryan period, hence we understand how old and how important the city of Korkai was, that its pearl fishing activities had been mentioned even in Mauryan sources like that of the Arthashastra. BRW locally made related ware, pearls and shell remains dating back to 200 BC to 200 CE have been found in the site of Korkai. NBPW shirts, which is a later variety of fine pottery, northern black polished ware, parts of northern black polished ware have been found, and that suggests that Korkai's settlement began as early as 8th century BC. So from all the archaeological evidences, especially the ceramic and the shell evidences, we come to an understanding that the settlement in Korkai was there in around 8th century BC. Early artifacts include pottery and shell bangles, confirming Korkai's historical significance in trade and industry, supported by radiocarbon dating and extensive archaeological excavations. So here we get that there were early artifacts like pottery and shell bangles, and those has been confirmed to be the earliest evidences dating back to 8th century BC through radiocarbon dating method. Uraiyur. Now, Uraiyur is identified as the early Chola capital, and it corresponds to the present-day city of Tiruchirappalli, was an early Chola capital described in Sangam literature. So, Chola dynasty had two phases, early Cholas and the later Cholas. During the time of early Cholas, which is during the Sangam age, Uraiyur was the capital, and it corresponds to present-day Tiruchirappalli. It is a fortified city and has been described with impressive buildings highlighting its political and military importance. So this city was greatly fortified, and there were impressive buildings inside the fortification, and thus we get to know that this was a city of both political and military significance. Period 1, when excavated, revealed BRW graffiti marked sherds and Brahmi inscriptions from 1st and 2nd centuries. So Brahmi inscriptions from 1st and 2nd century AD have been found here, along with black and red ware in period 1 of the site. Artifacts findings include a cistern, dyeing vat, period 3 linked to the early medieval period, indicating a continuous occupation. So this site was under continuous occupation, and that can be known from the fact that period 3 has been linked to early medieval period. So up until early medieval period, the site of Uraiyur, which is present day Tiruchirappalli, has been under continuous human occupation. The period 2 findings included russet coated ware showing a continuity in material culture with evidence of advanced urban infrastructure and crafts production. Kaverippumpattinam was the main Chola port. Kaverippumpattinam, a major Chola port, has been described in classical accounts as Kaveris or Kamara. So, in the classical accounts, the name Kaveris or Kamara indicate to the port of Kaverippumpattinam, which was the main trading center of the Chola Empire. Pattinapallai dedicates extensive descriptions to Puhar's bustling markets and its vibrant trade activities. So Pattinapallai is a source from where we get to understand the Puhar's economic vibrancy, and all kinds of vibrant trade activities have been described in this Sangam literature. Location. It is identified on the Tamil Nadu coast, where Kaveri River flows into the Bay of Bengal, highlighting its strategic importance. So this is a place where the Kaveri River makes an estuary with the Bay of Bengal, and thus we get to understand the strategic importance of this place, because one of the main rivers of southern India joins into the Bay of Bengal at this place. Found artifacts from 3rd century BC to 12th century CE, including irrigation reservoirs and brick platforms for landing boats. So all kinds of artifacts right up to 12th century CE have been found in this place, showing that this has been in continuous human occupation from 3rd century BC to 12th century CE, approximately for 1500 years. And what else do we get here? We get irrigation reservoirs and brick platforms where boats used to land. Soundara Rajan in 1994 documented Puhar's evolution and significance in maritime trade, emphasizing its role as a central hub of Chola trade network. So thus, this was a very important place for Chola economic activities. Now, Kanchi or Kanchipuram. Historical significance. Kanchi is mentioned in Sangam texts. Later, it became the Pallava capital, renowned for its cultural and religious importance. So, this was the capital of the Pallava Empire, and it is still very much renowned for its cultural and religious importance. Revealed multiple occupation periods, including BRW, which is black and red ware, beads, terracottas, and iron artifacts, indicating continuous habitation. So all these findings indicate that this site was under continuous habitation. And what are the important things found here? They are BRW, beads, terracottas, and many other iron artifacts. Early finds include a Buddhist shrine, Roman coins also found in the vicinity, highlighting its diverse cultural influences. So, founding a Buddhist shrine in far south of Indian subcontinent indicates the fact that the religious culture of the time in Kanchipuram was very much tolerant. We also get Roman coins in the vicinity of this city, and thus we get an example of diverse cultural influences. Findings suggest Kanchi's role as a significant trade hub from 1st century BC, supported by numerous archaeological artifacts. So from 1st century BC, this city has been not only religiously significant, but also very much significant as a trading hub. And that can be evidenced from the numerous archaeological artifacts found from this place. Excavations underscores Kanchi's long-standing importance in the South Indian history as a major center of trade, religion, and culture. Our next important site is Vasavasamudram. This was a city which acted as a connection between Kanchipuram and the Bay of Bengal. This was situated on the Palar River and is very crucial for trade because it connected the site of Kanchipuram to the sea. Excavations yielded amphorae sherds, related ware, beads, terracotta items, and brick structures indicative of its trade activities. So what are the artifacts which we get here? They are amphorae sherds, related wares, beads, and terracotta items, along with different kinds of brick structures which indicate to the diverse trading activities in the site. No BRW has been reported, which is odd considering that BRW has been reported from almost every sites of the Sangam age, and that suggests the not getting of BRW from Vasavasamudram suggests that there existed a different trading pattern in this place compared to the other sites. Findings indicate Vasavasamudram was an important port during medieval Chola period, supporting long distance trade. So during the medieval Chola period, which is approximately 5th, 6th or 7th century AD, there was long distance trade done from this site, and it was very significant and important during the medieval or early medieval times. Historians suggest Vasavasamudram might represent ancient ports like Neyyapara, emphasizing its historical significance as a trading hub in the Chola period. So thus, Vasavasamudram, by acting as a connecting spot between the Kanchipuram and the Bay of Bengal, was a very significant trading center and an important port during the medieval Chola period. Kodumanal. Kodumanal is another important site which acted as an industrial hub. This is located on the northern bank of Noyal, a Kaveri tributary. So Noyal River is a Kaveri tributary, and on the northern bank of Noyal River, there existed Kodumanal, known for its gem and jewelry work as mentioned in the Sangam text. So in the Sangam text, this site is mentioned as a significant jewelry crafting area. Finds include iron and steel tools, gemstone cutting, spinning and weaving equipment dating to 3rd century BC. So this was comparatively a very old Sangam site, and we get iron and steel tools from this site, which was significant for gemstone cutting, spinning and also weaving activities related to textiles were conducted in this site. Over 150 burials with inscribed potsherds, inscriptions in Tamil, Brahmi and Prakrit languages highlights its cultural diversity. So here we get burials with grave goods as inscribed potsherds. So all these inscriptions in the potsherds that were as graved goods were written in Tamil, Brahmi and the language was Prakrit. Thus, we come to know of its cultural diversity. Evidence of shell bangle manufacture, spinning, weaving, and gemstone cutting indicates a thriving craft industry. So, there were specialized professionals dedicated to making a certain kind of craft, and they were shell bangle manufacture, spinning, weaving, and gemstone cutting. Rajan's classification underscores Kodumanal's significance as a major industrial and trade center in early historical South India, contributing to regional trade network. So thus, this was an important trading center in early historical South India. Now, evidence of crafts and trade. What are the evidences of craft and trade we get from all these sites? References to pearls, precious stones and shell bangles in Sangam literature highlight the extensive trade networks. So there was existence of extensive trade network, and that can be understood from the references to objects like pearls, precious stones and shell bangles. Inscriptions and poems suggest thriving trade economies and specialized craft production in early South India. Champakalakshmi, who is a famous historian who contributed a lot regarding the understanding of urbanism in South India, argues that early urbanism was driven by trade rather than deep-rooted socio-economic changes. So according to historian Champakalakshmi, the early urbanism originated because of dedication and extensive effort towards trading networks. The trade activity led to the emergence of urban enclaves in 3rd century BC, which later declined by 6th century CE. So these trading activities led to the growth of urban centers in around 3rd century BC, and then it all total declined in about 6th century CE. Archaeological findings from sites like Kodumanal provide crucial evidence for evidence of transition to early historical urbanism and development of centers of craft production. So thus we come to an understanding that there was huge scale specialized craft production in the southern part of Indian subcontinent, and along with that extensive trade networks. Historians' perspectives on urbanism. What were the opinions of different historians regarding the emergence of urban culture in the Sangam sites? K. Rajan's revision proposes a revised chronology for Kodumanal, dating it to early historical periods from 400 BC onwards, challenging earlier classifications. So there, K. Rajan has mentioned that Kodumanal dates back to 400 BC onwards, and thus he challenges the earlier classifications. Trade networks. Indo-Roman and inter-regional trade significantly influenced urban development in South India, as evidenced by archaeological findings. So, Indo-Roman trade and trading between different territories within southern part of Indian subcontinent was very much an influencing factor behind the urban development in South India. Findings from Kodumanal and other sites reflect significant socio-economic transformations driven by trade activities. So, the findings from sites like Kodumanal reflect to the fact that there was significant socio-economic transformation because of the different trading activities. Chanpakalakshmi's hypothesis links the emergence of urbanism to trade activity rather than deeper socio-economic changes, suggesting trade was a primary driver. So it was because of trade that urbanism came into existence. Archaeological evidence from Kodumanal and other sites provides important insights into the early historical period, highlighting the impact of trade on social and economic status. So, in conclusion on South Indian urban centers, we will discuss a summary of the entire presentation. The South Indian towns and cities, especially the coastal ones like Muchiri and Kaverippumpattinam, were crucial hubs in Indo-Roman trade networks, as evidenced by extensive archaeological finds and classical accounts. The Sangam literature provides rich descriptions of urban centers which, though not always matched by archaeological evidence, offers significant insight into the cultural and economic life of these cities. As the Chera capital, Karur was a major center for crafts and trade, with substantial evidence for local minting, trade with the Roman world, and significant literary and archaeological findings. The Pandya capital, Madurai, was significant cultural and economic hub known for its crafts, trade, and third Sangam. Excavations and inscriptions corroborate its described wealth and importance. Korkai was central to the pearl fisheries mentioned in both Sangam poems and the Arthashastra, with archaeological findings supporting its status as a major port from as early as 8th century BC. Uraiyur and Kaverippumpattinam were significant Chola centers with extensive archaeological evidence of their roles in regional and international trade networks and their detailed descriptions in Sangam literature. Modern historians like Champakalakshmi and Rajan have revised traditional views, emphasizing the role of trade in driving early urbanism in South India, with a significant impact on social and economic transformations evidenced by extensive archaeological and literary sources. So that was a detailed archaeological perspective on the sites of the Sangam era. In our last video, we have discussed about the political history of different dynasties like Cheras, Cholas and Pandyas. However, in this video, we have gone into the archaeological historical context of each sites. I have tried to cover it as much as possible. Hope you have liked it, and through your support, I wish to bring brighter contents in future. Thank you so much for your support.